Bienvenidos todos al Museo de Historia Mexicana de Monterrey. Tenemos el honor de estar esta noche con la doctora Erika Patka, directora del Museo de Artes Aplicadas de Viena, de la Universidad de Viena. Ella quiere que agradezcamos también la presencia de Rosemary Benedict, que está aquí, una colega suya que trabajan en la misma universidad y ceramista. El programa, la conferencia consta de tres partes. La primera va a ser sobre el Art Nouveau en Viena. La segunda parte, el arte después de la Segunda Guerra Mundial y la gran variedad de artistas que tuvieron la suerte de contar en ese periodo. Y habrá una tercera parte, que los que se gusten quedar, será sobre cerámica. La recibimos con un aplauso y les agradezco su presencia aquí. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At first of all, I would like to thank Director Amores and the board of the museum for the kind invitation and the opportunity to speak to you in this wonderful museum. Yesterday, I had the occasion of visiting it for the first time in my life, and I must confess I'm deeply impressed not only by the marvelous objects, but also by the way of presentation and by the high standards of technical presentation, which was in some way new to me. And I may want to, in fact, congratulate you to this museum. Your town must be very happy to have a museum like this. So please let that. Will you take the light off? Well, this is the first thing I wanted to show you. This is a very well-known building in Vienna. It's the House of the Sezession. This is a hall for changing exhibitions, and it was built in 1898, and it has a special meaning. As you certainly know, Vienna was at that time still a large empire. Austria was a large empire, and Vienna was the capital where the emperor had the residence, and the Habsburg monarchy had about 14 nations, 60 million inhabitants, which we can hardly believe now, since we have shrinked to about 7 million inhabitants and Vienna having only 1.5 million people. So you can understand why I'm so impressed by the size of your country. Anyway, to manage this enormous country, you had to have a very effective and well-trained military army. And Austria had, of course, a very efficient bureaucracy. That means that everything was very regulated and life was very strictly organized by certain rules of society, of fashion, of behavior. And also art was, in a certain way, very traditional and not very let's say, internationally orientated. So, in the end, in the 90s of the 19th century, there was a group of young artists who wanted to be free, to bring new movements into art, and to organize expositions in their own way, and to speak to the public in the new language. So they founded an association called Sezession. And the first thing what they needed was an own hall for their exhibitions. And this is the building. It is was a white square, a cube, and it has a groove, a ball of golden leaves. And of course, the Viennese, who are very conservative, and they still are, They made their jokes and they called it the golden cabbage. Now this, as you know, is a very significant piece of Art Nouveau drawing with a significant forms like flowers and hair coming down in waves and a female figure very often used for ornamental purposes. To publish this new movement, they founded a periodical called Vers Sacrum, which is Latin and means the Holy Spring. That means they wanted to start in life for the arts. And this was their periodical Vers Sacrum. Now, just to show you a few pieces of this curvilinear style with floral elements, a piece of furniture, the whole thing seems to move. I mean, this is the international kind of Art Nouveau, which you will know from France and from Belgium. So that was the beginning also in Vienna. And at that time, the artist used to design a complete house. They wanted to create a so-called Gesamtkunstwerk, which means the entire building should be made from one hand, from one idea. And that shows you, for example, the door and the wall painting and the wallpapers and everything done from one artist. This artist is called Otto Brutscher, and he was also teacher at our university that was at that time called School of Arts and Crafts. And it was the most progressive school on the continent. That means it was founded after the example of the Kensington School of Arts in London. And since Austria was a very large country then, it had many talented young people to come to Vienna and study at this School of Arts and Crafts. Many of them got teachers afterwards and got members of the Secession. When they were members of the Secession, they got teachers or vice versa. So this is Colo Moser. Colo is a very important teacher. He's specialized on graphics. And this is just a little calendar that shows also this significant kind of work of graphic work in a two-dimensional way. And that is, I think, very specific for the Viennese Art Nouveau that is later called Secessionism after the Secession. Could we reduce the light a bit? I think you can't realize the colors. Would it be possible? So this is also an interesting print by Colo Moser. So you realize he works in a very flat way. He doesn't show perspectives or wrinkles or shadows. So the back is black, the floor is white, and you get the idea of absolutely two-dimensional work. Interesting in this piece is also this patchwork pattern of this lady's dress, which is clearly influenced by Japanese art. The Austrian artists got to know Japanese art on the various world fairs, and they accepted it into their work. As I told you before, the artists wanted to create the whole ambiente of a house, so they even styled the ceilings and the floors, but in fact this was not very common. This is a special case when Josef Hoffmann designed a house in the countryside for a very wealthy family. Now you will know Kaiser Franz Joseph, Emperor Kaiser Franz Joseph, as you know, Maximilian, another member of the Habsburg dynasty. And this is a print by Kolomoza that was spread all over the monarchy on the occasion of the 60th anniversary of his government, because he came to the throne when he was 18 years old in 1848. So he was a 78-year-old man at that time. So you can imagine this new movement of art was not so much supported by the emperor or the court or the aristocracy, but by the well-educated and liberal bourgeoisie, by the families that could afford a certain standard of furnishing and building their homes and sending their children to art schools. That's very interesting. Our school was the first one where young women were allowed, girls were allowed to study, because they were not allowed until 1900 to study at the Academy of Fine Arts. Now, this is also another example of this two-dimensional style with this pattern in the background. And now you will realize that the ornament gets a very geometrical line. And that is, I think, a specialty of Vienna's Art Nouveau. This is also a nice example of a pupil of Kolomoza. And here is Kolomoza again himself. See the squares and the circle and the circles around the head of the of these three ladies and this very pure and constructive elements. This is a piece of furniture showing the same ideas. In 1903, there was founded the Wiener Werkstätte, that's maybe called Viennese Workshop, by Kolomoza, Josef Hoffmann, and Bankier, who would finance the whole thing. And they wanted to create very well-done artificial works, and they wanted to put the stress not on the value of the material, but on the idea of the art, of the high quality of the artist's work. And you see a fine piece of textile in the background that's used for furniture, and this is a little vase in silver, and also this geometrical style again. This is a teapot of hammered silver, and this is by Josef Hoffmann. He was one of the most important architects at that time, founder of the Wiener Werkstätte, professor at the School of Arts and Crafts, teacher of many, many students, and he really put his sign on this period. At the same time, you must not forget that Vienna was also the place where Sigmund Freud lived and discovered the subconscious and the psychoanalysis. And I think this piece by Alfred Kubin may show you a situation, a scene from a nightmare of a horrible animal and a little child running away in horror. So this is called the adoration of a very, very fat creature. So this may be our fears. And here as well, this dog watching an obscure landscape, a magic world of fear. And one would not like to go. And in the contrary, here you see a very fine painting by Wilhelm Bernatzik, an Austrian artist who has studied in Paris, and I suppose he had also contacts with the French symbolism. So this is the entrance to paradise, just another kind of landscape with flowers and trees. And if you watch these trees coming down like strings, it's very similar to the Colomosa we saw before. This is also a formal element of dividing the landscape into parts and going through a curtain into another part of this landscape. Another landscape that is cold and pure and frightful, it's by Giovanni Segantini. It's called The Bad Mothers. These are the mothers who won't care for their children, don't want to nourish them, so they get punished and they get set out in the desert. Also a kind of a symbolistic work, which is really a very, very important painting of that time. Now, this is the church in Steinhof by Otto Wagner. Otto Wagner was a very important architect, in fact, and in some way the father or the patron of these young artists, since he was much older than they. He died in 1918 at the age of 80. So when the young artists of the Secession were in their 30s, he was almost 70, just in comparison. And he designed very important buildings for the city of Vienna, and he had utopian ideas of how let the city grow, and he would be worth a whole lecture to explain what he has done for our city. Could you focus this a little bit more? Thank you. This is a stained glass window of this church by Otto Wagner, and the glass window is by Colomosa again. So I just wanted to show how the terms of graphics is here presented in a piece of applied arts. Now this is by Otto Wagner again. He was the one who designed all the stations for the underground railway, which was constructed in the late 90s and about 1900. And this is one of the stations. This is not in function anymore. It was transformed into a cafe, as you can see. But it has been beautifully restored the last years with all these golden paintings, this ornament along the roof with these golden flowers and golden ornaments. And I think it's a very beautiful example of this period. I have realized that you have a very long tradition of ceramic works and tiles in Mexico and in Spain as well. So I thought I should bring you this Majolica house in Vienna with a very beautiful ornament of flowers in very beautiful colors and in these golden lines going up and down. And here, these golden portraits of the young ladies are designed by Colomosa again. So you see the artists used to work together. That was the speciality of the times, not only in the Wiener Werkstätte, but usually many artists liked to work together. And sometimes you couldn't even tell which part was by which artist. This is another building by Otto Wagner in this rather geometric and clear and pure style. It's situated on the Wien Fluss. That's a little channel leading to the Danube. And the ornament caves. Now, Now this is the Postsparkasse, the post main post office by Otto Wagner with rich decoration on top. And I chose this view because it's a typical place in Vienna from the late decades of the 19th century. That's on the right and the left side what the houses in Vienna used to be. You have to keep in mind that Vienna got torn down the walls that circled the city only in the 50s of the 19th century. And during the time of Emperor Franz Joseph's reign, the population of Vienna increased from 500,000 to 2 million. That means there was an enormous amount of building and constructing new houses, and of course there was also a lot of misery when people wouldn't have places where to stay at all. One could rent a bed for a night or so. There were people who had flats and others would just rent a bed, not even a room, and they had to leave in the morning, so it was a very time of growing very fast and with all the problems one would have. Now this is the inner side of this post office, and it was the first building in Vienna not constructed by iron but by aluminium, and it's still in function as it was built in 1904. And it's a very well-known place to the tourists, especially the Italians would come and conquer Vienna looking for all these places of Art Nouveau. Now, as I told you, this association, Wiener Werkstätte, tried to create this total piece of art, and I think all their dreams came true when they got a chance in Brussels to build this palace for the family of Mr. Stocklet. And it was designed from the roof down to the floor, to the gardens, even to the pots for the plants. So the architecture was designed by Josef Hoffmann again, and many other artists paid their tribute and were invited to work with him. So this might be the ladies' sitting room, and please look at the fine colors, this yellow and black being repeated in the chairs, in the wallpaper. Since Mr. Stocklet was a collector himself, he used to have shelves for his fine pieces in here on the right, both sides of the door, and on other places in the house. Now this was the music room, for example, and I think it's quite elegant for a private house. It's all designed in red, in black marble, decorated with rich gold, the edges all coming down, golden ornament, and I think it's really very precious looking. So this is the dining room, the table meant for 20 persons, and this is one of the finest pieces of art of the time. And it is still in use. The family Stocklet is still living there, so it's not open to the public. But it is still in the very best condition. And here you please mind the floor with the black and white squares. It's also a very typical form. And the carpet, and the same elements in the back of the chairs. And the most significant piece of art are, of course, the mosaics on both designed by Gustav Klimt. He has become so very well known everywhere. I have seen his postcards in your museum shops here in Monterrey and was very happy about. This is just a detail, this is a tree of life. And in these golden pictures and mosaics, Klimt was influenced by Byzantine art from Constantinople, from the Byzantinic times. And they were filled in with precious stones and pieces of glass and all kinds of precious beads and so on. Now this is a famous painting by Gustav Klimt. This is Judith or Salome with the head of Yohanan. And he became very well known now because of the erotic women he used to paint, and all these decorative ornaments in their clothes and in the wallpaper. And here you can realize just the faces and feet of the girl, and all the background in pure gold and the meadow like like an ornament itself, like a carpet, and also the coat of the man, an abstract ornament. And these days now, one likes to see it as the first step to abstraction, to abstract art. So Klimt gets another interpretation at the moment, as you also can see here, as this lady's face is also surrounded by a very abstract ornament. It has its own value, got a new sight and a new value in art history, this kind of painting. Now, as I have realized, death is very present here in Mexico in various forms. I brought some examples from Austrian art as well. And so here you see the dark person, the dark figure of death, and the very colorful and bright human beings, the women and the girl, and the mothers and the child of this of life, prosperous life against the darkness of death. And this is just an example, a work by Leopold Forstner. He's the artist who worked at the mosaics designed by Gustav Klimt, just to give you an idea what it looked like. And at the same time, in another province of Austria, in Tirolia, in Tyrol, in the mountains where life is very hard for the peasants, Egger Lienz, the painter Egger Lienz, created this picture of a family in front of an empty bowl, praying, maybe asking for bread, praying to God. So I just wanted to show this great difference at the same time in the same country. And this is a painting which Egger Lienz painted during the First World War, and I think it's very interesting, and he shows how peasants become soldiers. They are going over the soil, they're living in an aggressive way and not holding their tools for the field but weapons. I think that's also a thing you have very well documented in your art in Mexico. This is a painting by Egon Schiele of his first period, where he also paints in a very two-dimensional way, using ornaments in the clothing, still influenced by Gustav Klimt. This is a later work. This is his wife, Edith. Shortly before her death, she died in 1918, the same year as the painter Egon Schiele himself. And here you may look at her hands, which are cramped a little. That means she looks a bit anxious. at the beginning of what we call this expressionistic way of painting, where the artist wants to show the inner life and the feelings, the condition of a person. He became very well known and scandalized by his nudes, and this is one of the examples. He even got to prison. As I told you, the Austrian public is still very conservative and always has been, is much more enthusiastic about music, opera house or theater, but not so much about new tendencies in fine arts. So you can imagine that even the painter Oskar Kokoschka, who is now known all over the world, aroused an enormous scandal with his work in eight with a drawing like this, maybe a prostitute worn out and hurt and unhappy. So this is also a painting showing death. He was invited for at Easter's at a friend's house, and was the evening before, and he saw the lamp lying on the kitchen table, and then he created this painting of how life is vanishing and death coming. It's a very decadent atmosphere with this little white rat and this animal in this aquarium, and the smell, this decadent smell of the hyacinth on the right side. So people were terribly shocked when he brought these paintings to exhibition. Now this is a very, very beautiful painting showing the painter, the artist Oskar Kokoschka, with the widow of Gustav Mahler, of the great composer. Her name is Alma Mahler. I think she is very well known by her autobiography. And this was a very great romance between young Kokoschka and the older Alma Mahler. It's painted in very lucid and transparent colors, and he himself seems to be quite happy at that time. And a few years later, when she had left him and he went to fight in the World War, where he was severely wounded. So this is self-portrait a few years later, background, and a man that has already learned pain in life. This is a contemporary artist also. This is Gütersloh. I just want to show it in comparison, showing the same opaque colors as in the painting of Kokoschka. And now we are in the 20s. Could you focus it again a bit? Thank you. This is Kari Hauser. He's just on the turn between a certain kind of realism and with a little influence of cubistic art, just showing the contours, the lines, and leaving out the white, the itself. So it has a little transparent effect. And here's a small painting, a self-portrait, his wife and his brother who died as a young man, and he is very often appearing in his pictures. So this is slightly influenced by cubism, which was not very popular in Austria and not frequently used by artists. This is the sculpture Anton Hanak, and this sculpture is called After War and Destruction. So this is a man hopelessly stretching his hand up to the sky and showing his despair. also a piece of art, the feelings of a man in an expressionist way. This is a piece of Ernst Nepo, showing a realistic way of painting with the two children in the center and the parents staying back, the woman outside the house. Frequently you in this time on the picture, the pictures show an interior and an outlook to the landscape. This is by a woman artist, a student of our school. In fact, her name is My Ullmann, and the style was later called kinetism, from kinesis, that means motion, and she may be influenced by the futurist painting, wants to show certain movements. Figures, one laying over the other, almost covering them, bring a certain motion into this picture. This is the upper part. These are the four evangelists with their attributes, the eagle, the lion, the angel, the toro, and they coming down like a flash, and I think that might be the meaning that their word, the New Testament, coming down to people like a flash, and it still has a golden background and a very decorative atmosphere, maybe influenced by Klimt and his golden backgrounds. This is another work of this style by Erika Giovanna Kleen, who went to the United States and worked successfully there. This is painted in, it's a watercolor, in fact, so you must excuse it's a bit pale. It's called Revolution in Vienna. People throwing stones, other ones hiding behind the windows, the guns looking out from behind the wall, people lying on the floor. And since we had a civil war in 1934, this is some kind of a vision, I suppose. So this is the architect Adolf Loos, and he was very much opposing Josef Hoffmann and the style of the Wiener Werkstätte. He was representing a very functional and clear style. He did not want the whole house designed by the artist. He wanted the inhabitant to have the opportunity to change a chair, to change furniture, and not to be dominated completely by an artist. So if you want to change a carpet after 3 years, the artist wouldn't allow you. So he was an opponent, and he even said ornament is a crime. That is to understand in that way that he didn't want the craftsman's energy and time to be spent on ornaments when there are so many people are suffering and not having enough to dress or to live in. It means it was also some kind of social idea. Above you see a house built in 1910 for the family Steiner, and underneath this is the house built in 1928. So I wanted to show you, in general, things that are in opposition to each other and other groups of works who have a certain context. This is a house for two families in a dwelling area on the occasion of the Werkbund exhibition. That was an international architecture exhibition where many famous artists were invited to take part and to construct buildings for a whole area. And this is the so-called Karl Marx Hof, named after Karl Marx. And this was constructed in 1927, when after the First World War, there was a great need of houses and homes, especially for the working people. And this is one of the great achievements of socialists in Vienna, that after that war, they built enormous number of houses for the working people. And this is the best known by the architect Karl Ehn. And during Civil War, as I told you, there were the inhabitants struggling. It was like a fortress. They were shooting out of the windows, and it was their representative places where they really felt their power and where they could get shelter. So this was the first part. I think we're quite good in time. I have now to move to the 30s, where, as you know, we had a very difficult times for artists because of political reasons. There was the so-called Austrofascism under Dollfuss and later Schuschnigg, and when in 1938 Austria was occupied by the German Nazis, then it was for many artists even impossible to work. They had either to declare their political ideas, whether they wanted to follow the regime, and if not, they would not be allowed to work at all. That meant many of them emigrated, as you know, and not only artists, but also writers, philosophers, scientists. And I think Austria only realized the last years what it owns to its Jewish population. And I just told Mr. Amores that we still appreciate Mexico's attitude in 1938, when it was the only country in the world who protested against Nazi occupation. I think that's not the right one. Please take the first carousel again. It was just one left, because this is the 70s. Rosmar, ich habe nur eine Pause gemacht im ersten Zirkel und dann müssten noch weitergehen mit Hutter. Ja, können wir da jetzt überhaupt reingehen? I'm sorry for the interruption. Da ist ein kleiner Spalt und dort habe ich eine Pause eingelegt, damit wir die Kriegszeit überbrücken. Nein, nein. Shall I come and help? Ist alles rausgeflogen? since, that means the past 50 years. In Austria, there was no such style as Surrealism. One important representant of this style may be seen in Wolfgang Pahlen, who in fact lived in Mexico. So we got to know him, my generation got to know him only during the 80s, when there was the first personality show in a Viennese museum. Now I start here with a work by Wolf Hutter, who belonged to a group who were called the Fantastic Surrealists. That means they were not really surrealists, but they had some ideas taken from them. And Wolfgang Hutter likes to paint flowers and girls with bright eyes and very good figures, and this is just one piece to show how Austrian artists after the war tried to fill that gap that existed during the 30s and 40s. So they had to find a connection again to the international arts, and the young men were very keen in learning and getting information. So as you know, Austria was divided in four sections, controlled by the four international powers, Russians, Great Britain, America, and France. So each section would get a certain influence by representative institutions. Let's say we had the British Council, we had the Institut Français, and we had, of course, the America House. And when I was a child, I used to live in the American section, so I used to get my very first books from the American Library. I mean, this is just to give you an idea of how the situation was and how hard it was to get any information at all. So the climate, even after the war, stayed rather conservative and repressive, and people were not very keen on art anyway. They built up their houses again, and it was really very hard for artists to make their life. So this is Wolfgang Hutter, now retired professor of our university as well. Next, please. Ah, so that's me. Sorry. This is Ernst Fuchs, who also belonged to this group. And this is another example of how Austrian artists deal with the problem of death. In the contrary to your country, where you have a fiesta on the 2nd of November, in Austria, the problem of death and the fact that man has to die seems to be rather a taboo at the moment. Everybody has to be young and successful and pretty, and that's important, and it's an influence all over, coming all over from the United States to Western Europe, and I think that's a problem, and it's mainly the artists who think of this problem and show it in their work, and one of them here is Ernst Fuchs. At the same time after the war, an important painter was Herbert Böckli. He was of the older generation. He was director of the Academy of Fine Arts during the war. And he continued his paintings, which is full of colors. This is an Austrian landscape called Erzberg. It's a mountain where you gain iron. And it's in a, I mean, it's anyway a not political piece of work. So artists who used to stay back with the political opinion could survive in some way. This is the young artist, then young artist, Arnulf Reiner. He was 20 years old when he painted or created this picture of with the title Ocean, Ocean. It shows the underwater atmosphere with very strange animals and human beings or not human beings, a very confusing world. In some way, maybe to see in some connection with Alfred Kubin and his nightmares, if you remember. And as his work goes on, it became more and more dense, and in the end it became black at all, and he covered the canvas with black oil paint. So you will see a piece later. I'm sorry, things got mixed up, so they might not be in the right order now. No, at the same time, it was Oswald Oberhuber, who in fact lived in the French section of Tirolia, and he was very much influenced by the Institut Français. So when he was 18 years old, he went to Germany to study at Professor Baumeister, and he was one of the first who brought the informal style to Austria, the informal. And he was even the first one who also created informal sculpture. That means the artist starts a piece of work and he would not know what it would look like in the end. It's just by chance what it will be the result. Another piece by Hans Staudacher, who is mixing various techniques like painting and drawing, and he became very successful and still working in this style up to now. That means almost 40 years. So this is Markus Brachy. He threw the paint with a very thick brush. He throws it against the canvas. So this is also a piece of informal, in a very expressive way. Uh-huh. I'm sorry. This is a very important man. This is Fritz Wotruba. He spent the war times in Switzerland. And when he came back, he became professor at the Academy of Fine Arts. And he really was the professor of some generations of younger artists and influenced them a lot. And as you see, he reduces the human limbs to cubes. And as you see here, I realize that it might seem familiar to you, because this is a church looking like a sculpture being built up on a hill, and this is during the time of construction. It still got the name of the constructing firm on top, so it's not finished, but it hasn't changed. Only the hill has changed, because it's now grass and not pure soil. And I think now it reminds me of your holy places and temples here in Mexico. This is another artist working in a more realistic way. His name is difficult to spell. It's Alfred Hrdlička. That means he's of Bohemian origin and it's a Slavish, Slavic name. As far as I know, he's the only Austrian artist who ever had a big active exhibition here in Mexico, I think during the early 80s, I think. This is an artist who calls himself Hundertwasser. He is quite well known and he was very much appreciated in the 60s and 70s already. This painting is called Rain of Grass. And in his very personal style, he started creating houses. And I also think he got influenced in Mexico when I got to see some houses here in Monterrey with these roofs and these bright colors. I suppose he must have been here once. So this became a very great attraction for tourists, while the art historians don't appreciate it so much because they say it's rather on the edge of kitsch, but I shouldn't speak like that. Well, now this is an interesting phenomenon that artists want to leave the square of the canvas. And this is a painting by Max Weiler, and he's adding wings to his canvas. They might even move. So he wants to go out to space and to give a new shape to his paintings. I think we have again too much light here. Can you reduce the light? Because I don't need light at all on my table here. Isn't it better like that? So, another artist, his name is Günther Brus, started in the early 60s using his body as a medium, and he started painting himself here in front of a painting in the background. And when he used to go like this through the city, the police came, of course, and arrested him immediately. This is Arnulf Reiner again, and he also uses his body, but mainly after having been photographed, he adds painting on a certain photograph or even pictures or works of art by other artists. But in this case, he behaves like an actor, being Ivan der Schreckliche, that was the Russian Tsar, Ivan the Horrible. And he tries by his painting to give an accent to a certain feeling, also a way of expressive meaning. In that way, giving more power and more expression to the photograph itself. He wants to stress a certain feeling. Now, this is what I was talking before. He started to overpaint his own pictures, and there are some, they are completely black or just a little corner left out, or crosses painted over with black or then red or other colors as well. And then there existed some kind of mystery. Everybody asked, so what would be behind? And he got very famous with this way of painting on with this idea of hiding things. This is another one showing himself with various grimaces, with a mimical series of photographs, and always putting stress on certain lines of his body and so giving it another expression. Now we were talking about the human body becoming a new medium. And this is Otto Mühl here painting and throwing paint and other things even on a young woman. And Mühl and Brus and Hermann Nietzsche and some others were the ones who created this this movement that's so-called Vienna Aktionismus, Viennese Actionism, that means the main thing is the action of painting, not so much the result of it, but the time being when the artist sets to work, and it was of course very shocking. And in the end he had to emigrate for a certain time. He and some others went to Berlin and stayed there until everything had calmed down. And then he founded a community. This was very much used during the 70s after the Students' Revolution. This kind of art was also a kind of protest against the strict rules of society. As I told you, in this very conservative climate of after-war Vienna, so they used these ideas of freedom and personal freedom to show in their arts. And of course, it was a great scandal. Now all these artists are well known all over the important museums of Europe, and their photographs or relicts, that the things that remains would be sold at enormous prices, and that's how the market takes over these things. First thing is a scandal, and afterwards it's commercial product. So the artist can't escape, and I think they don't want to escape the rules of the free market. This is Hermann Nietzsche, and it, as you may see, the 79th action in 1983. That means he has already almost 20 years of his Orgien, Mysterien, Theater. That means orgiastic, mysterious theater. So he's writing real scripts on the whole performance, and it's all after a certain order things are done. Here the animal is slaughtered, and in this way he wants to set free energies and aggressions of people to be peaceful afterwards, to reflect and to be at this orgiastic event, and in the end these animals would be eaten up like one did in the old times, in the ancient times. And in fact he uses also some symbols, or let's say clothes of priests of the Catholic Church, so he also has still problems with authorities. But on the other hand, he is very well known and appreciated, so he was invited to create a stage of an opera by me, Salome. And so when Yohanan is killed, the blood would, red paint would run down the backstage, and it's very interesting. I mean, how artists are accepted after a certain time, so even the Viennese get used to their art. But first they always have to have a certain success abroad, and then they may come back to Austria, and and the Austrians then will accept them. Uh-huh. Now this was the end of the first, so please be careful. Not let it go. This is a painting by Maria Lasnik. She is the same generation as let's say she was one of those who was working in Vienna during the 60s, and she was always in competition with other artists like Oberhuber and Rainer at Galerie Next St. Stephan, where I used to work for 10 years. And then she went to New York, and she became a feminist artist, and she was in her way fighting for the woman's rights and woman's lib. And she especially shows her own feelings and how her body feels, and she calls her paintings self-awareness paintings. And in this one, I think she doesn't feel very well crouched down to the floor. Ah, now it's a pity we got mixed up in our order. This is a sculpture by Karl Prantl, and he calls them the meditation stones. They are very calm and quiet, and you really can stand there and meditate. There's no movement, no expressive dynamics. It's just calm. And he, in fact, has been frequently to Japan, and I think it might be a certain influence from there also. And this is a specific piece where I can show you how he follows the lines and the colors and what's in the stone itself, the surface of the stone. And in this way, he just brings one corner to the surface, like pulling off the skin of the stone. And you always feel the need of touching them, and it's always a very good feeling to have this stone under your hands. This is Georg Eisler, who had to emigrate with his father to England, and he became a politically engaged artist in a realistic manner. And here, this is just a scene as it happens nowadays everywhere in the world. Police fighting against civil people. This is a sculpture by Gerda Fassel. He's at the moment professor at our University of Applied Arts. And I wanted to show her in opposition, in contrary to Maria Lasnik's self-awareness paintings, because I think this woman is very self-confident and has no fears whatsoever. And this is an interesting work by Export, who also belonged to this circle of Aktionist and body art artist, and I think one can read it in that way, that she shows the women's situation being fixed on a certain point and not being able to move or not being able to leave this red circle. She has to follow the shape of her surroundings. I think this is a very interesting work indeed. And this is Franz Ringel. He calls it the Adam and Eva driven from paradise. And I remember in the Bible it says, and they realized they were naked. So he even took the skin off so you can see their inner organs, and they will be only freed from the sin by Christ's death on the cross, the crucifixion you can see in the middle, but it's not very clearly to see. Can you Can you change a bit? No, it doesn't work. Now, this is a piece I wanted to show in connection with Max Weiler's painting with the wings. So this is another way of leaving the conventional places and forms. This is work by Haus Ruck. That's a company of, I think it was four artists. And they brought for the first time the plastic material into the arts, and they wanted to leave the gallery and the museum, so they just let it hang out of the window, just right on the street. These were the tendencies of the mid of the 60s in Austria, where you got all kinds of objects made of plastic and blown up and completely new materials and situations. Now this is Walter Pichler, also an important artist, and he is showing his own private ritual places. He is living in a small village in Burgenland, where he owns a place, and there he builds up little temples and showing his sculptures. He doesn't like to send them to exhibitions, in fact, so one has to make a pilgrimage to his place to see his work. And this is a drawing in preparation of sculpture, such a ritual. Oh, I'm sorry, this is upside down. This is, in fact, a little shop for candles designed by Hans Holland. I hope you can imagine it turned round. It was completely done, the surface was completely done by aluminium, and this is still to be seen in Vienna. It's from the late 60s. This is another painting by Maria Lasnik now, and this is called Woman Power. So that might be her dream. When she lived in New York, she wanted to be a giant, to just go over the roofs and be powerful. Now this is a house by an Austrian millionaire. That's what a villa would look like nowadays. The architect is Wilhelm Holzbauer. He was also professor. And I just wanted to show you this in comparison to the Palais Stockley, so you would see what things would like be like now. And this is the maquette of part of the university in Salzburg, designed by Holzbauer. This is an interesting piece of interior of a travel agency, also by Hans Holland, the one who designed the candlelight shop. And you must imagine that Vienna doesn't have any seaside, doesn't have any palm trees. So for us, a landscape with palm trees would be paradise. So he created interior with palms, and in the background a curtain, that the box where you would buy the theater tickets. But after a few years, the whole office was demolished and doesn't exist anymore. This is just a piece to show you the influence of pop art in Austrian art. This is by Attersee. Attersee, that means is a lake in Austria, and since he was a sportsman sailing, he accepted the name of the place where he was born, and he calls him Christian Attersee. and this is a so-called soup with seahorses. He's still inventing crazy little instruments like pills that makes your soup being blue, and other kinds of things. And he's also a musician. He's also giving concerts and a very productive and very successful painter. This is another piece showing how artists would work on the problem of death. This is in fact a tapestry. It got a bit dirty when it fell down, it seems. And this is a tapestry done after a drawing, of course. This is a woman drawn by Adolf Frohner, also one of our professors. And he wants to show the ugly sides of life. As I have said, people and especially women have to be attractive and young and beautiful. He wants to show us that's not the reality. In real life, women are not always slim and are not always beautiful, and still they have to be accepted. And that's the way he deals with this problem of being a woman. Now, this is also a new way of finding new ways for sculpture, a new material, very simple, very poor, and leaving the conventional forms of, let's say, a human body. It's maybe also the fact of the chance playing a part in this, playing a role in this piece of art. And interesting also that it's being painted. And in contrary, I want to show you this. It's only called square and line. It's also very poor material. It's just a very cheap wooden plates hammered together and just taking its effect from the surface of this material and how it's combined, the light wood with the dark. And after all these experiences of installation and video art and body art and so on, in the early 80s, there was a very strong movement back to the painting, and it was called the Neue Malerei, the new painting, and one of the representatives is Hubert Schmalig showing his wife in a very simple but very colorful way. And this is Adolf Frohner again, and he shows the two elements in life, that is love and death. So this big expression of this woman and the death looking over her shoulder. I'm sorry, I'm brought down again. This is by Rockenschaub, that's where I wanted to show how art now leaves the galleries and the museums and goes out to the street and to the public. So this is street art in Vienna and sponsored by a firm, Austrian Airlines. That's also upside down, I'm sorry to say. These are the four apocalyptic riders, also bringing death to mankind. And now it's another chapter, which I thought might interest some friends of Rosemarie Benedict, who is here with me and been to Monterrey before. And as an homage to her and her friends, I would like to show you a few pieces of our collection. This is from the 20s, in fact, also from Wiener Werkstätte. Yes. These are some pieces, as I said, from the 20s with a slight influence of Art Deco. This is Hilde Jesser. To you it must be very familiar to have this blue and yellow contrast, which is quite unusual in our country, to have this heavy contrast of colors like red and green. This is Waldi Wieseltier, who used in America after her studies at our school. And this is a bow with a top, also in bright colors. This is upside down, a vase. And this is Kitty Rix, also in very lively colors. And the jar. And now this is about 60 years later by Maria Pilger, who was also professor at our university. And some of her students will be seen later with their works. This is Matteo Thun. It's a can upside down. He came to Vienna as a professor from Italy. He was member of this famous designer group of Memphis, the postmodern design, and he brought new ideas to Vienna in the early 80s. Like this. He used to create coffee landscapes, that means the cup and the plates would cover a table like a landscape. And this is a diploma work of one of his students. I brought this just for a joke to see how funny art can be. A Rococo lady in her ball dress. And this is something quite different. This is by Helimidis. This is in fact a work with three pots where you can put plants in soil, in earth, and you can take away the parts to the left and the right and put water in, and the water would communicate with the roots. And this is a very straight and clear and pure ceramic object, like an architecture by Helene Avramidis. And this as well. So this is a funny piece by Barbara Beranek. So I just wanted to show you the various positions and the various possibilities a ceramic artist may have. These are lamps by Hedwig Rotter. So the material has a different density, so the light comes through where it's thin. And this is an interesting piece of work. It's porcelain by Gabriele Hein. And she wants to give the impression of a textile, which I think must be very difficult in this very hard and difficult material. This is, in fact, a tiny little thing, just 7 centimeters high. It's not big like that. So you may recognize an artist who has been living for many years in Mexico. She's Gerda Gruber. She has been a professor at the University for Arts in Mexico City. And as I know, she has been fighting for ceramics to be recognized as art and being taught at on a higher level at the university. This is a warrior. And I think she may be influenced from historical Mexican sculpture. But when I saw her works in original on exposition in Vienna, I immediately thought about this body feeling and body awareness, and I thought it might also the condition of mind or the feeling of a person with his difficulties and problems. So we used to look at things from the inner side in Vienna, not only from the surface. This is a combination of two figures. And they are really quite big, almost men size. They are about the same size. These are sculptures by Julie Hayward. And she calls them my personal rockets. These are plates of an enormous size, about 80 centimeters. And the artist is of Turkish origin. And she's using Turkish letters or parts of Turkish letters as a kind of an ornament on these plates. This is a work by Judy Drataitz, and she calls this series reciprocus. That means there are two forms put together in reciprocal situation. And I think her speciality is the dealing with the surface, the glazing. It's really amazing what effect she is getting in her objects. I have a whole series with the pyramid in the center, you see, and there is one hole for one orange and then for three and five. So this has a geometrical system in it. This is also a reciprocus. You can turn it upside down and you have the same effect. And she shows an interesting contrast by glazing the two parts in a different way. Now this is Lilo Schrammel, and she has specialized in showing movement in a hard material that wouldn't move at all. I think here one can get her idea very well. I'm sorry, that's upside down again. These are figures in a series of 365 pieces. The artist is Petra Lutnik. She is living from time to time in Mexico and teaching here as well. I met her 2 days ago in Mexico City and she gave me her slides. And she told me, for her it's not so important, the figure itself, it should vanish in the light, but what stays from a man is just his shadow. And she chose the number of 365, the days of a year, to give an idea of time, and she thought 1 year would be just one period that would represent time quite well. This is a plate made by her. And here she wants to show transparency and presenting her object she wants to give this effect of flying away, being so thin and light that it might fly away any moment. And now this is our friend Rosemary Benedict, and this is a pot, and I think it reminds of this tree of life as we have seen in your museums. And she in fact loves animals, and so she usually uses animal forms in her work. And she, for many years, she has done a very colorful objects, and only the last few months she started working in completely white material. So this is a special period in her work. And I think this is amazing. They are really brand new, these bowls. They are just come out from the oven. It started by just the head looking out of the surface, and then it was a relief, and now the fish are springing and jumping all over it. Sorry, it's a pity. Please imagine it the other way around. Now you have a little bear, and she always likes jokes, and so this little cat has just got her ears painted in black and white and nothing else, just to give an accent to the piece. So, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it. I once again want to beg your pardon for the accident we had, so we got a bit out of the order. I hope you will excuse. So if there are any questions or if there's anything you might want to know, I will of course try to answer. Pardon? Yes, please.
I'd like to know if the church, where we saw the square church.
Yeah?
Where is it?
The church is in Vienna, in Mauer.
Does it have color, or was it gray? Is the original color gray, or does it have color?
Yeah, it's made of poor concrete, so the surface is gray. It's not painted at all. It's just cement, concrete.
I know, but it was meant to be that color.
Okay. No, it hasn't.
Not color. Okay, concrete.
Yeah, it hasn't. It's no paint on it. It's just pure as it was fixed. Yes.
You can see.
Disculpe si la.
I get it. That's interesting. Oh, that's the other way around now. Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm not able to speak Spanish. I would love to. Yes.
Gracias. Algunos autores consideran al taller vienés como el inicio del Art Deco, especialmente con el Palacio Stoclet en Bruselas. ¿Usted qué opina al respecto?
Yes.
¿Podríamos considerar ya, desde su punto de vista, el taller vienés realmente como el inicio del Art Deco?
Not of the Art Deco, but of the Secessionism. No, I mean it was already the climax. I would say, because they started in the late 90s of the 19th century, and the Stoclet was built from 1905 to 1911, and with the outbreak of the World War in 1914, I mean, everything broke down because nobody would be able to afford precious art like that. And after the war, the fortunes have been lost, and it was a very sad situation for the artists at all. And the Vienna workshop would end very sadly because financial problems in 1933. And we are happy that the Museum of Applied Arts was able then to buy all the objects that were still there, and especially also the books with designs and calculations. And this is a very important possibility now for the art historians to reconstruct the work of these artists. And there have been a lot of research and a lot of publications on that art. And I'm very proud to say that the past 15 years, there have been exhibitions on Wiener Welle art and works of these artists in the United States, in Japan, and of course all over Europe. And I myself was a courier with objects in Madrid and in Barcelona, and we had splendid exhibitions there. And it would be a dream of mine to bring things like this to Mexico, and maybe sometime it would be possible that you might see these objects in reality and not only on bad slides.
How has the political situation affected the artists, the political situation of now?
Well, it depends on the certain times. I mean, after the war, it was very hard because of the financial reasons. But as I told you, the Austrians are not very keen and not very progressive or avant-garde liking in Vienna, so the situation was very hard. I myself have been working for 10 years in a gallery, so I know their needs at that time. That was from the late 60s to the 70s. But I think after the socialist chancellor Bruno Kreisky, the situation altered a lot, and when we then had in the 60s three important galleries, we now have about 20 or 30 because everything has become commercialized. And I have been myself to many art fairs in the 70s in Bologna and Basel, and all these international contacts have helped a lot. And since the economic situation in Austria is very good at the moment, there's also enough money, or let's say it's never enough, but there is much money spent on exhibitions and for museums. We're just building a new Museumsquartier, that means a place next to the big museums, Art History and Natural History Museum in Vienna. There is an old Baroque palais, which is now turned to be a museum, and there will be added new buildings for certain collections and exhibitions and permanent shows and video shows and library. This is a project that would amount to I don't know how many millions, and they're always people saying, ah, that's too much money for art, so things have to be reduced. First you have a competition of architects and you get a first prize, and then it takes you 10 years until they start building it. Now they have started 1 year again, but it has shrunk tower that was planned like this is now like that, and what has to be like this is small, small again. So it's always a problem with avant-garde art in Vienna. I'm very sorry to say, even if the situation now is much better than when I started my career 30 years ago, I must say that.
And how has the current end of with Haider affected the artist? Do you feel any reaction of the artist with the current situation?
I must say we all are worried. It's a bit complicated to explain in a few words, but to give you the situation. The past 13 years, we had a coalition of Socialist Party and Conservative People's Party, and then people were fed up with this, because that means that every official post was set for two persons, one of each party, and one wanted a change. And now it was this Mr. Haider, who is just the governor of a province. He's not in the government yet, so it's only his party. And it's only his words and his speeches and how he seems to on national socialist, on Nazism, that makes us all worried, because he doesn't want foreigners to come into the country. But at the other hand, I must say that our population is shrinking, so I think we really would need immigrants to come, and not only people who work in summer and must go home in winter again, things like that. But in a certain sense, he will be of course, this party might be, of course, laying more stress, let's say, on popular art or on folk art or traditional art, and will not be very open-minded to internationality or to experiments. And his party came into mind is due to the fact that almost one-third of the population elected the socialist, the second-third voted for the people's parties, and the third to this Haider party, which is called Freiheitliche, I don't know, Freedom's Party. And he is just a man promising things he would never could pay for. So that was the way he got the workers and the people with a small income to leave the Socialist Party and go to his party. But in the few weeks, this government is now supposed to work. There have been demonstrations all the time, and there have been heavy protests from the European Community, as you know. And for my opinion, it has exaggerated enormously abroad, because at the time the government was installed, I myself was in Greece, and I was terrified to see on television Haider and our government, and in the next moment to see Hitler with his Hakenkreuz flags, because that's not the reality. I mean, Austria is a very democratic and liberal country, in fact, but it was such a terrible constellation that the two parties who had the 13 years coalition didn't want and just couldn't work on together. So the president had to choose the rest of it. And now these heavy demonstrations are going on. There is one supposed to have been on Saturday when I was already coming close, so I don't know what it was like. There were supposed to be, I don't know, 200,000 people going to the streets, so I really don't know what will happen, and I hope it won't last longer, but nobody knows what would happen then. The only thing that's very interesting, that the Green Party, that's the colored, the party that stresses ecology, is gaining. So they had 7% in October at the elections, and now they seem to have got up to 15. So they are gaining from this situation of the equivalence of the three main parties. So I don't know myself how it will be going on. But there have been artists protesting and suggesting to leave the country because one can't stand it. And I think that's not the right way. I think we have to stay on our place and do our work, and we have to speak for our opinion and to change things for the better. So I am very sad that we are so being opposed by the other nations, because I think we don't really deserve it, because nobody wanted this party in the government. They only wanted them as a strong opposition to control the two other parties. And now there happened a thing that nobody really wanted. So that's my opinion, and I hope I'm right. But nobody knows how it will be in the near future. I will learn when I come back. Thank you very much.